Good morning. It's an honor to be here. I've never been on Faulkner's campus before, despite living in Auburn for about 14 years of my life. I know a ton of people that have gone here, and I know professors here. Actually, y'all's president is an audience of our ministry. His kids have come through. His youngest daughter is in our ministry now. And then Nathan Capps is a good friend of mine. And so it's an honor to get to speak here this morning. I know I only have a few minutes. And despite what Jonathan said, almost probably everyone you've heard from is a much better speaker than me. And in addition to that, Nathan asked me to speak on a topic that he said when he asked me, he said, is it where I am? Nathan asked me to speak on a topic that he said you guys would be bored by. So that's kind of a tall order. And he specifically asked me to talk about the importance of the intellectual life or education to faith. In other words, like, why it's important to form your intellect as a part of your spiritual formation. And I know that that's like a very boring topic for many of you, but maybe for some of you it's very, very important. Am I on? Can y'all hear me? I don't know if this stayed the AV. Everybody hear me? Good. And so I want to start in a place that is far removed from this topic, and I want to talk about a small town in Canada. Can y'all go to the next picture? I don't even know how to pronounce the name of this town. It's near Montreal. It's in the Quebec province. And it's a town of just a few thousand people. It had a historic downtown. It had a railroad that went through it. And it was mainly supported by the tourism industry. And in 2013, in July 2013, a train carrying crude oil derailed downtown, exploded, caught a lot of the downtown on fire, and 47 people were killed. This is the middle of the night. 47 people were killed, and something like 66 out of 72 buildings in the downtown were either destroyed by the explosion or had to be demolished because they were so damaged, right? They say that the area of destruction was 1.2 miles wide. It was all right in the downtown. This town was almost destroyed by this accident. And you might think something like that happened because, you know, the engineer controlling the train didn't slow down enough going around the curve, or that something was wrong with the railroad track. And the disaster didn't start there. Instead, in the middle of the night, the train was parked on a ridge just outside of town. And the emergency brake failed. And the train began to roll backwards. Now, it wasn't a steep ridge. It was a 1% or a 1.2% gradient. And so that's not very steep at all. I mean, the roads that we drive on, that they're considered steep, and you have to be warned if they get to 6 or 8% gradient, right? So you'll see those signs in places. And so you know that the slope, a 1% slope, isn't that much. But that train slowly kind of drifted into the hill, it caught up speed, you know, it got to the downtown, it derailed and exploded. And so you might think like a disaster like that would happen at a kind of a climactic moment, but instead it started much earlier with that kind of slow slide down the hill. And I think that often when people lose their faith, that sometimes we think it happens all of a sudden in a moment or in a couple of days, that they encounter a tragedy or they read a book or something, or they decide that they no longer want to live a life that God calls them to, and they just make a decision one morning that they're no longer going to follow God. But often what happens when we lose our commitment or our loyalty or our faith in Jesus, what happens is it's a slow drifting away. And the way that the train, the disaster, the explosion really began much farther away with the train slowly sliding down the hill. So often when people lose their faith, it begins much earlier, months or even years earlier, and it's a gradual sliding away. This semester I'm doing a discipleship group with about 10 students in my ministry, and we're studying through the book of Hebrews. It's a very slow study. It'll take us about 2 years. But it gives us an opportunity to really reflect on what's being said and think about it deeply. And one thing that's come out is that the writer of Hebrews, we don't know who it is, that what he's concerned about is the people he's writing to kind of rejecting Jesus. But he's concerned about it happening gradually, right? He's concerned that these people, and they might be new Christians, their background might have been Jews who converted to Christianity, they're experiencing maybe some social pressure or even persecution, that after they became Christian, everything became harder. And so slowly they just start to kind of lose their commitment to Christ. And so the writer of Hebrews is warning them about that. In Hebrews, I don't have the clicker, but Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1, you put it up there. It says we must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. Like, the concern of the writer of Hebrews is not this sudden, like, you wake up one morning, you're a devout Christian, and you decide at lunch you're rejecting Jesus. But the concern is that you're going to slowly drift away from your commitment or your loyalty. That what's going to happen is much more gradual, like the train sliding down the hill. Some scholars, it's very disputed, but some scholars say the word that's translated drift there, sometimes it's translated slip away, that it can even have the background imagery might even be of a ship gliding past a harbor. And so you just get this idea of this gliding, this sliding, this drifting away, something much more slow, much more gradual. And it's such a concern that the writer of Hebrews, notice, go to the next slide, please. Notice the word, he says, we must pay the most careful attention to make sure that you don't drift away from your commitment, to make sure you don't drift away from your faith. I mean, the concern, and again, this is obviously a concern that a biblical writer would have, but the concern that he has here isn't that you're going to be a devout Christian who falls into sin, like greed or pornography or something like this. The concern is that what you're going to do is you're going to drift away from your faith, that you will end up rejecting Jesus. And it's important because the writer of Hebrews thinks that's such a real risk for us. It's such a real risk that you, every single one of you sitting here, that you could gradually lose your commitment to Jesus, and that one day you could wake up rejecting Jesus, not even realize that over the last year or two you've been moving in that direction. It's such a real concern that the writer says we have to pay, notice the language, the most careful attention. In another place, in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 11, he says we must make every effort to make sure that we enter the rest. Right? So notice that language. Pay careful attention. Make every effort. The reality is that you're at such a risk as a believer of slowly drifting away from your faith, of slowly losing your commitment, that the kind of intensity you have is to pay careful attention, to make every effort. That you can't put your faith on autopilot because the culture and your own temptation and the things around you will slowly erode at your faith. And so pay careful attention. Make every effort. And if we're going to make every effort to make sure we don't drift away, we've got to ask ourselves, well, what causes us to drift away? And on the one hand, like what's happening perhaps in the communities that the writer of the Hebrews is writing to, it could be social pressure. You know, a post-Christian culture or friends or family who don't follow Jesus and you're mocked or you're kind of put pressure on because you're a believer. When I work with Chinese students who become believers and they move back to China, they don't know if they can get jobs there because of their faith. Can you imagine that kind of social pressure year after year of you can't get a good job because of your faith in Jesus? That can cause you to drift away. I mean, Hebrews 3:13 talks about the deceitfulness of sin, that sin can deceive you and think that it's the best form of life. And you can slowly through the deceitfulness of sin, drift away. Jesus, in the parable of the sower, he talks about faith being choked out by the cares and concerns of this world, by the desire for riches. And so those types of things can kind of kill your faith. But, and you know where I'm going with this because of the topic, I think one thing we don't talk about a lot is the way that intellectual concerns or questions. I don't mean this in a nerdy sense. I just mean questions about our faith and how to understand it, how it interacts with culture, and how to make sense of it, how to respond to objections. That those types of things can slowly erode out of faith by having a question here, an unanswered question here, or an unanswered criticism there, or just something that seems odd to us in the Bible. And it slowly shakes our faith. The other day I was in a meeting with students of mine. About 30 of us are going to go to a place in Florida working with terminally ill kids. And they were talking about how we need to make sure we're praying for the kids. And one of the girls, she spoke up and she said that, she started crying. She said that she knows as a Christian that we should pray for the kids that are there who are terminally ill with cancer and other things. But when she was in middle school, her best friend was diagnosed with cancer. And her friend was a devout Christian, and everybody close to her was a devout Christian. Everybody prayed for her constantly for years. And people told her if they just prayed and trusted in God, God would take care of her. And she says, my friend died. And she says, to this day, I can't bring myself to pray for those types of things. To hear someone who's asking an age-old question, how can a loving God allow someone, my friend, to suffer in this way? And that's not just kind of a nerdy concern, right? That's a concern that's keeping her from praying. And if it's going to keep you from praying, just imagine the effects of that for over years, over several years. The distance you're going to feel from God, questioning if God cares for you. Those are the types of intellectual things that can happen in our lives that just slowly push us away from God. We wake up in a few years and you realize you've never sincerely prayed in the last 2 or 3 years. And what that does to your spiritual life, what that does to your relationship with God. Right? No, it's not the case that that for every single one of you, the most kind of important risk to your life are those types of questions. But for some of you right now, the seeds have been kind of sown for you to walk away from the faith in the years to come because of questions like that, or questions about the Bible, or questions about whether God is real, or questions about whether Jesus really exists, or just questions about how to make sense of different things in Christian theology. And so if we're going to make every effort to make sure we don't drift away, part of that has to be that we have to make every effort to make sure that we don't have these kind of intellectual things that come into our lives unanswered, and we drift away. My conviction as a college minister, working with very intelligent students, is that most churches and most ministries never really help students form their minds, never push them in that way. Maybe a few nerds, but most people, like in church, we make sure that people, we want to form their lives, how they act, right? So that you don't sin and stuff like this. We work on making sure people's emotions are formed. We have worship that is kind of geared towards making sure you emotionally connect to that. But most churches don't really work hard to make sure that people have an intellectual foundation to their lives. And when you go out into a post-Christian world, or you go out and you encounter things like a good friend or family member dying, and you have all these questions, those can begin to kind of erode at your faith. And so I know I'm almost out of time. The main thing I want to kind of press upon you is this importance that if you lose your faith, it won't be all of a sudden overnight. It'll be gradual. And one thing that kind of push you in that way are these intellectual concerns, and that you need to make every effort to make sure, not just that your life, not just that your emotion, not just that your kind of community is keeping you rooted in faith, but also that intellectually you're being formed. Because you're going to encounter questions, you're going to encounter people who object to Christianity, you're going to read things that bother you, you're going to encounter things in life that shake your faith. You're going to see trends in culture that conflict with our commitments as Christians. And you're going to have all these questions. And so, in my very, very limited time, I just want to give you two guidelines that I give the students that I work with at Auburn. And the first, and I know this seems obvious, but the first is don't wait until a crisis. My sons, they play rec league basketball. They're by no means the best. But I noticed that they want to practice after they do poorly in a game, right? That's so often the way we're kind of wired is when something becomes emotionally relevant to us or concerning, that's when we want to invest time. But just like in sports, if you want to be good, you got to practice all the time and not just when you do badly in a game. In this case, what I encourage people, and you guys are educated, you're going to live your life among educated people. You know, you're smart, intelligent people. You're some of the most educated people that the world has ever known, right? And that you should be making a habit, not every day, maybe not even every week, but just making sure that you're reading things or listening to podcasts that helps you kind of form your understanding of theology and understanding of apologetics and philosophy and things like that. And that sounds way nerdier than I mean it. I just mean read things that help you kind of form how you think and what you believe about your faith and how your faith engages with culture. And the second thing, and it was too long to put up there, but I put up there, challenge yourself. And what I mean here is, look, a lot of you are in programs and educational programs where you are being pushed to the limit intellectually. I work with students who are getting their master's or PhD in engineering or math or physics or other areas, and they are working on things that they have to study hard and think hard and at the very limits of their ability in their areas. And I asked these students, I said, have you ever had to do that with your faith, with things about theology or the Bible? And they always say no. And the guideline, the rule of thumb I try to give students is make sure you're pushing yourself intellectually with your faith just as hard as you're pushing yourself intellectually with your studies. Many of you are studying things that are kind of pushing you to the limits. And make sure you're reading things and thinking deeply about things and investing intellectually in things of the faith, just like you are things academic. Because again, you're not just going to wake up one day and decide you don't believe in God. But some of you, in the midst of struggle with depression, in the midst of tragedies, in the midst of encountering people who aren't believers, things are going to slowly erode away, like the girl I was talking about earlier. And you're going to have things that you begin to question or answer problems you don't know the solution to, things that seem odd to you and you don't know how to explain them. And that's slowly going to kind of erode at you and kind of challenge your commitment to Jesus and to God. And what I don't want to happen for any of you is that when you end up one day is that you decide you don't believe in God, you don't believe in Jesus, you reject him. Again, I appreciate y'all's attention, and I appreciate the invite. Let me pray, and then you guys can go. Father God, we are grateful for you. We're grateful for your word. Father, I pray you work in our lives to help us, Father, to pay the most careful attention, to make every effort to ensure, Father, that we hold on to the faith, that we don't drift away. And Father, I know just from working with college students for 13 years now that there are people in this room, Father, who are beginning to have doubts or having questions, experiencing things, Father, that are making them question the Bible, question you, question the truth of Christianity. And Father, I pray that through them, through their friends, through their community, through professors, Father, that you can encourage them and work, Father, to help them form their minds, Father, so they can hold on to their faith. Father, help us be a people who in all aspects of our life, Father, are paying the most careful attention to make sure that we hold